Hello viewers and welcome to Electronics Club. We are glad to be the media partner of IPC IEMI 2024, a third year in a row. We got a lovely chance to speak with Dr. John W. Mitchell, the President and CEO of IPC, a thought leader with a doctorate in higher education management. He champions standards, regulatory changes, and workforce solutions in the electronic industry. So welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. It's good to see you again.
Yes, any day. So John, we would start with where we stopped last year and know the progress of IPC and the electronic industry in India and how the collaboration has been functioning yet.
Yeah, so IPC in India has continued to grow at a very fast rate. Our membership is growing. The participation in standards is fantastic. In fact, just recently, within about a one-year span, an India-initiated and largely India-participated standard was launched at the end of last year. And so we're seeing a large amount of collaboration coming from India. And a lot of that has to do with the team here. They're fantastic. Our India team at IPC does a great job. Gaurab is leading the direction. I also find his approach very collaborative in nature. There's a lot of different organizations. Electronics is a very complex ecosystem across the world. And Gaurab is working with many different organizations and countries in order to help the industry thrive and succeed.
So looking at where we left last year, I'm coming back to the same point where we right now spoke about the IPC. Let us look at India's electronic scenario, the landscape, and how the government has been helping the entire ecosystem to be more fertile.
Yeah, so India is a very important place and a very important role in the electronics ecosystem around the world. There have been, you know, challenges over the years with India in terms of infrastructure and things like that. A lot of that is starting to really, the barriers are lowering, which is very exciting for the electronics industry. We're seeing, for instance, probably the bright star is Apple, right? Apple coming to India and doing a lot of their phone development here over the last couple of years has really paved the way and shown the world that this is a place that you can develop high quality and high production level electronics. And that's just been a great example, and I think it will continue moving forward. Some of the things we talked about last year as well that are the strengths of India is, of course, the population base, the education level, the English speaking, and so just all of that combines. India is the only thing holding India back.
So when you say that, how can India work towards making India not holding itself, but rather pushing itself towards great heights?
Yeah, it's a tough thing that many countries face, right? So we want, as countries are working to expand and improve the country, they often will look outside their borders to bring in different technologies or different industries, right? The electronics industry isn't really an industry. I like to think of it as a resource because it impacts every single industry that exists. It's like water or energy. Electronics impacts every industry, whether it's automotive, industrial, telecommunications, aerospace, all of them don't succeed without electronics. So we actually are the resource that helps make all the other industries successful. So that's part that India has in common with other places. The challenges that I think many companies, as they've spoken with me, have shared is, again, it comes back to the infrastructure. There have been some moves forward, but there's still a long ways to go.
Okay. So we spoke about India. Let us have a look at the global electronic industry scenario. So you recently concluded the event at Malaysia as well.
Yes.
So looking at US, Malaysia, and India, and looking at the global impact that the Asia-Pacific region is having in the electronic industry, what's your thought?
The Asia-Pacific impact on the electronics industry cannot be understated or overstated. There is so much happening. It is surprising even to me, every time I visit, how much is going on in these regions. The U.S. is striving in many of their conversations to bring industries back, to reshore. You hear a lot about that in the U.S. But in comparison to what's happening out here, it's very, very small. I was amazed at some of the companies and the length and the size of those companies. Even American companies, some of their largest plants are based in Asia Pacific region, not in the US, because you have the skills here, you have some of the history here, and so the strength of electronics is really not, I think each country needs to be looking at how they incorporate electronics into their own country strategy, but it's not about a single country. It's about the world.
Right.
And the globe is reliant upon electronics. And so finding ways for countries to collaborate, I think, is crucial to the success of the world in terms of moving the our situations, whether it's sustainability or new technology or whatever the objective is. Mm-hmm. Working together is a better path than competing with each other.
Right. Especially when you said that U.S. is striving hard to bring the companies, the core of those companies, back to the U.S. Well, they are relocating to the Asia-Pacific region.
Yes.
So what's stopping U.S. or is there any change in the plans and policies that needs to be looked at right now?
In the U.S.?
Yes.
So in the U.S., a lot of emphasis has been around the CHIPS Act, right? So there's a lot of money focused on primarily building semiconductors. IPC has been working heavily with governments in that area to try to help them, as well as in Europe, to help them see that it's not just about semiconductors. Just building semiconductors actually causes bigger problems than it solves. Mm-hmm. It gives you some security, but if you don't have the ecosystem around it, you actually lengthen the supply chain and make things slower in the long run. So you need to, I understand that each region wants to have some security. We learned that through COVID, that when you don't have some local capabilities, mm-hmm. you can get into some big problems. So having that is a good thing, but having it exclusively doesn't work. It really needs to be a partnership of many different options around the world.
So U.S. has that infrastructure, U.S. has that cost power. Where does U.S. stand when it comes to talent? Is it something that actually is pulling the, you know, these companies towards the European and the Asian market?
I think it's pulling it more toward the Asian market, because right now a lot of that talent that the U.S. used to have 20, 30 years ago mm-hmm. is either older and retiring or has already those companies transferred out a while ago. At the highest end, in terms of design of some of the higher technology, the talent is there. But in terms of manufacturing and some of the other parts of the ecosystem, the talent is not there. The talent is in Asia. It's not in Europe either. So Asia has that strength. And that's why partnership is so important. Because you need to transfer knowledge, because that's a good thing as well, to spread the knowledge around, but you're still going to have centers of excellence around different areas of the world.
So how is IPC working with the U.S. government to develop that talent?
Oh, so our workforce efforts are part of that. So we sit on various committees and councils regarding workforce and trying to bring that knowledge in. It's one of the strengths of IPC in that so many of the workforce initiatives in the U.S. talk about improving the workforce. But if you don't have the knowledge in country and you don't have access to it outside of the country, where is it coming from? It doesn't magically appear. So IPC, being a global organization and working with experts around the world, has the opportunity to bring that actual know-how where it exists and share it around the world.
So when you and IPC are at the core of this industry and what's happening there, you are building that ecosystem across the world. What are some of the challenges, apart from, when I say infrastructure and talent, do you observe across the world that needs to be handled right away?
Yeah, the biggest challenge is geopolitical tensions. And I don't know what we can do on that front, honestly. Mm-hmm. We try to influence as best as we can. You know, We've seen different countries leverage trade and tariff in order to try to strengthen their own positions. More often than not, when those types of mechanisms are used, the people who are most damaged by that are not countries or even big companies. It's the small companies that get harmed by that. For instance, several years ago, when the U.S. put import tariffs on several different electronics goods coming in from Asia, the larger companies have many options. They have many subsidiaries. They can work around those regulations and work with them. The small and medium-sized businesses in the United States only have one option. They still have to get it from Asia, and now their costs just went up 25%. And so they suffered. Some of them went out of business because of these tariffs in an effort to try to strengthen something. So those kinds of policies, I think, don't actually solve the problem.
So you spoke about this geopolitical tension. There's this chip war that you also mentioned a while ago going on. Countries want to...
Every country in the world wants to own all of semiconductors.
All of the semiconductors. Okay, so we see that US and China up front, they are the loggerheads when it comes to the chip war. Who's going to win this war and why?
That's a really good question. If it stays a war too long, nobody. Because nobody wins in wars, right? It's just, you get what's left over. As opposed to thinking of it as a war, I hope that the investment in it will create great innovation in various places. It's very difficult to predict where innovation will happen. Okay? So I don't know who will win the wars, all right? But I think the people that think longer term and think systems instead of pieces will be better positioned in the long run.
Okay. So looking at the supply chain and the innovation that you just spoke a while ago, how do you see the electronic industry as a whole working towards solving this problem, coming up with new innovations and between this geopolitical tension, just easing the supply chain?
Yeah, so let me talk about sustainability for a minute, if I could, as a better mechanism for that. Instead of thinking about chip wars, when the world talks about global issues like sustainability, we actually find that we can agree on things because we pretty much have this planet we need to live on, all of us, right? And so where I'd rather see funding from countries, instead of having a war over semiconductor capability, I think it would be much better to sit there and say, let's invest in new materials. Let's invest in systems that will support recyclability, reuse, and all of the things around, you know, a true sustainable piece. Because we don't want to run out of the capabilities of using our electronics. I mean, if suddenly I told you that phone that you're looking at, you were stuck with it for the next 10 years, how would you feel about that? Maybe not so good. Because you change it maybe every 1 or 2 years, something like that. And the technology continues to advance. But if we advance the technology without thinking about the environmental impacts of that, there's only so far we can go. And with chips being increasingly power hungry and the numbers of them increasing, eventually we're going to, the studies that I've seen are actually predicting within the years, like, I can't remember the exact date, it's around 2040, 2050, we don't have enough energy on the planet to run all the microprocessors. Never mind eating or driving or breathing. There's just not enough energy, so we have to come up with new technologies. And if we looked at those problems and the governments of the world started investing in doing research around how do we do more efficient energy chips or use different materials or recycle materials, etc., those efforts will actually spur new innovation that will help both increase the level of innovation that happens as well as the sustainable nature of it. So I'd rather work on problems than work on competitiveness. Mm-hmm. Right? Does that make sense?
Yeah, sure.
Sorry, that was a long answer.
That's right. And I believe there's another question that should come here right now when you talk about being more efficient and having those innovations or technology that can help chips become more energy efficient. What role can AI play here?
Oh, that's a great question. So AI is a fantastic tool. Too many people in the world are afraid of AI. Just like people were afraid of the computer back in the day. Oh, I won't be able to type anymore. You're right. That skill we don't use, you know, we don't use normal old typewriters anymore. We use a PC, which word processing helps us do things faster, more efficient, and more intelligent. Well, this is the next version of that. AI is going to help, when we know how to use it, it's going to make us more efficient. It's going to give us more time. And so there will be insights we're able to gain using AI that would have taken us decades, maybe centuries, whereas AI can shorten that time frame. There is so much information in the world, and so much know-how is generating every few months that we can't keep up. So AI is this great tool that allows us to distill that to the information we can keep up with to make the changes needed and very quickly.
Great. So I see that IPC have been working with various countries on this front to bring that innovation and talent as we spoke about. How is IPC actually acting like a bridge or creating that bridge to support the entire ecosystem all together, hand in hand, not individually?
Yeah, so IPC, you know, I said in my closing remarks at the Malaysia event was, my country is electronics. When electronics succeed, every other industry succeeds. That's the bridge we're creating, okay? When we can figure out how to make better electronics, more efficient electronics, more powerful electronics, more innovative electronics, greener electronics, every single industry wins. So that's the way that we're trying to connect the whole world. And that's why we're going to all countries, you know, countries all over the world. It's not just an effort for one country or one region, because the electronics ecosystem has spread all over the world.
So what's the next five-year plan for IPC globally?
The next 5 years, there will be a tremendous amount of change. Mm-hmm. You will see IPC looking to do more of what we've talked about in terms of working with countries as well as companies that can influence the way electronics are made, the way electronics are designed, and what electronics can do. That you'll see our mission really grow and magnify in that regard.
How about India plan?
It's part of it. Like I said, there is no country, there's one world.
No, so what plans do you have for India? How are you working with the Indian government and the companies here?
Yeah, so the specifics of that, that's why I have local people that do that stuff, but in, we continue to partner with not just Indian government groups, but also association groups in India, as well as the industry. So bringing all of that together at events like this IAM event we're at today, allow us to really think larger. It's not just IPC's opinion. It's not just one company's opinion. It's not just one country's opinion. By bringing all of that together, we get better solutions. One of the books that I like to refer to is, it's called The Wisdom, I think it's called The Wisdom of Crowds by Sir Wiki. It's one of the top 100 business books ever written. And what it talks about is the power of diverse thinking in solving problems. So if only India, or only the US, or only the electronic engineers tried to solve the problem, we'd have a less good solution than if we worked together. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like, are you familiar with potpourri? Do you know what potpourri is? So potpourri is a mixture of flowers and herbs, and when you have a lot of different ones and oils all mixed together. The smell is wonderful.
Wonderful.
It's better than just one of them. Mm. So I think what we need to be doing is potpourri when we try to create the best electronic solutions we can in the world.
So the last question here, John, from my end is, there's too much happening across industry, like you mentioned. where do you see IPC working around with the defense companies or the industry, I would say, in India specifically, and how you are contributing to them for better and easier and cost-effective solutions?
Yeah, so we focus really in three or four different areas. So first, standards. Mm-hmm. Industry standards, our industry standards are global. And so bringing the expertise, so for instance, like India's space program, bringing the expertise that NASA helped contribute to that India can also work on, and vice versa. So collaborating in specific areas. The automotive industry, we bring that information from all over, all different types of automotive makers, so that it strengthens each local industry by being a global group. Second is the piece we talked about earlier, workforce. Mm-hmm. We do the same process in trying to raise the skill levels. You can't hire somebody and be satisfied, because as soon as you hire them for a certain set of skills, they're old. We must continually be training and adding skills. Latest one that's very, everybody's excited about it is, of course, the skill of using AI. The next one is advocacy. So we need to work with governments. They set regulations, they make legislation that impact this global change, but they also provide funding that can accelerate the changes that we need across the world. And the final area is solutions. We work towards solutions, things like new technologies, like advanced packaging in the semiconductor arena, or better design solutions, or solutions for sustainability, or workforce solutions. When we're working on these solution areas, it really allows us to leverage things like standards in education and advocacy to find answers to these very big and very challenging problems.
Great. So I'm done. So okay. Do you like to add anything to our discussion, or do you think there is something important that
I'm sure
like to convey
my
to
team
our
will
audience?
Cringe at everything I said. They'll go, "Oh, that was terrible." But I think the overall message I would leave with you is that IPC is here to help electronics work, build, innovate, and be designed better. And when electronics improve, every other industry improves. Mm-hmm. We're not a natural resource, we're a man-made necessary resource.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your time today.
My pleasure.
And thank you, viewers, for being with us. See you again. Bye-bye.